Indian Institute of Science has not failed to surprise us with their studies and inventions, even during pandemic times. Dr. Sriram Ganapathy, assistant professor in the Electrical Engineering Department of IIT, has recently come up with an interesting study named Koswara, which is to detect COVID-related infections using just the voice samples. To explain regarding this interesting work, we do have Dr. Sriram Ganapathy. Dr. Sriram, could you just tell us in a brief what is Koswara and how can Koswara infer COVID-related infections using just the voice samples?
Namaste, everyone. Thank you for the opportunity to talk to you regarding this. So I am Sriram Ganapathy. I'm a faculty in the Electrical Engineering Department at the Indian Institute of Science. So this study, the name is Koswara. It's a combination of Ko for COVID and Swara for sounds. So what we try to understand and bring about the tool is to use sound-based methodologies for COVID diagnosis. So the idea is that, you know, we want participants to use any smartphone or web-connected device, record some sounds like breathing sounds or cough sounds or speech sounds, and then also indicate their health status. And this data then gets uploaded to a remote server. And using the data, we try to provide, look at the data, form some analysis algorithms, try to come up with some hypothesis on how to distinguish between the sound coming from a healthy individual with no infection versus the sounds coming from a COVID-positive individual. So this effort, thanks to several of my fellow colleagues at the Indian Institute of Science, as well as medical professionals, doctors at three or four hospitals that we work with. So this effort started about a year ago using the idea of trying to use a totally crowdsourced setting. So the term crowdsourced means that the person is providing us data or using data in a totally remote location without having to come to a centralized facility or any other common place. So in a crowdsourced setting, we would like participants to provide data. And we would also like to perform analysis in a remote server, but bring back the result of the analysis back to the user itself in his cell phone, either through website or through an app. And this is what we have been building together. We try to put together data and algorithms to support this hypothesis, and has been ongoing for the last 1 year.
Sure. So my question is, a software or a computer designed by you, how can it know the person or the sample giver's normal voice if he is a COVID infected?
So that's a very good question. So let us try to understand a little bit of the science of what the COVID infection does to the body. So when you know a person is exposed to the virus essentially incubates in person's respiratory tract, right? Through the nasal or the oral cavity, it gets to settle down in the lungs, and the virus starts to grow in the lungs of the individual. So what typically happens, you might have seen in other media or other reading, you might have found that, you know, the CT scan or the X-ray of the patient show some very different distinct characteristics of COVID infection. So what then this happens, this manifests, is that the COVID infection in the lungs and the respiratory system will affect the sounds that are generated by the system itself. So your cough, your speech, or your breathing sounds are a result of the coordinated activity of the lungs and the respiratory system. So when there is any infection or there is any ailment in these respiratory organs, what happens is that the nature of the sound, the characteristics of the sound changes. So for example, we have seen that COVID positive participants, if we ask them to cough and we record and analyze these cough samples, they have a distinct vibratory nature in the cough. This is sort of an harmonic like behavior in their sound characteristics, and given enough number of such samples which have these characteristics of COVID versus a certain number of samples which do not have vibratory activity, meaning coming from normal healthy individuals, we can devise, you know, computer algorithms that extract these right features and then say that, you know, these characteristics of the sound or the features from the sound look more like a positive individual or they look more like a COVID-infected individual, and that we can map it to a probability score, which says that you have a 60% chance of COVID or a 10% chance of COVID of that nature.
Okay, so far, how many voice samples has been collected in Coursera platform?
So we have collected close to about 2,000 samples from, thanks to, you know, many of the media and users or viewers like you. We would really also request more participants who are, you know, viewing this segment to kindly go to the website called coursera.iisc.ac.in. To contribute data, it takes about 5 to 7 minutes, and all it asks you is for any COVID-related health status as well as your voice and cough samples. And this process takes about 5 to 7 minutes. It comes to our resource. There is no personal data collected. And what we will use is to build our tools further based on this, or validate our tools on the data that you are giving on a daily basis. And the tool has about 2,000 samples so far, and you know, any age group, health condition, more data we create, you know, these machine learning based systems or artificial intelligence systems, they get better with data. We have ourselves seen that when we started the work, when we started looking at analysis, say 6 months before, our models were not so good. Over the course of data collection, we have also improved our analysis, have gotten more data to test our model. And we are, you know, making progress with every month of data collection.
Perfect. So speaking about accuracy, how accurate is Coursera?
So the latest analysis and results that we are, you know, currently under review, peer review for a journal, we have used the samples from the study and built a tool on it. And we are receiving around 93% accuracy. So the 93% accuracy number has to be, you know, dissected into two forms. So one has to look for the diagnostic testing. There are two ways to measure it. One is how many participants who actually have a COVID, but the algorithm is able to detect it. The other measure is how many participants who don't have a COVID, but the algorithm, when they come to the algorithm, it basically rejects them, as in it says that there is no COVID. So the two types of measures commonly used to performance evaluate these diagnostic tools. So what we have is the ICMR, the Indian Council of Medical Research, which is the leading regulatory body in the country for approval of diagnostic tools, has come up with guidelines for the two measures, how much measure each measure should be as a benchmark for the regulatory model to approve it. So the current benchmark, as late as May 2021, the benchmark states that the point of care tools, that the name given to these remote tools, whatever we are trying to build is a remote location-based tool, is called point of care tools. So the ICMR guidelines tell you that you need to be 95% accurate when it comes to what is called the true negatives, meaning if you have the model say positive, you are 95% sure that it is a positive. Okay, and the other measure that the ICMR gives you is 50%, meaning if the model says, if the person has a COVID and comes to the model has to be right at least 50% of the time. So these are the two key figures, 95% and 50%. So when we test our tool using the current state of what we have, we are 95, we are meeting the benchmark at 95, and the corresponding one for 50%, we are at 69%. So we are at least about 18-19% above the benchmark to qualify as a point of care tool. Of course, this is all a caveat. This is a function of the data that we currently have. We will do more thorough validation, and if the numbers and the results hold up, we would like to bring it to the ICMR's notice in the form of a formal application.
Perfect. And so the papers are being submitted and the trials are being going on. Is there any plans from you and your team to collaborate with industry for wider use and for the different applications in future?
So we have had several, you know, industry participation or industry people interact with us over the course of this, and we continue to do that. So what will happen is, you know, if this sort of a tools benefits and this sort of a tools performance meets the criteria set by, you know, the government regulatory bodies, then, you know, a massive population level scaling and setup of these, you know, surely we will be relying on industry help, you know, to come up with an app or that one can install in a cell phone and then do this testing, come up with, you know, more centralized ways in which multiple people can jointly do the testing. You know, these sort of things of massive scaling of this technology to population level needs, I think, you know, we will certainly be relying on industry collaboration, industry participation to, you know, bring it to the population scale. Right? Currently, the tool we have, as I said, you know, 2,000 people have contributed data and collected and developed the tool. But, you know, if it goes to the next cycle where, you know, 100 or 200 people are simultaneously trying to access the tool, you know, we don't think we have the software and the capabilities built in to handle traffic. So these things we would, you know, not try to do it all ourselves. We would rely on help from, you know, people who have done this for various products.
Perfect. So in that note, I'll be wishing you, Team Coursera, great success with this project. Thank you, Professor, for sparing your time to speak with ETV Bharat. That was Dr. Sriram Ganapathy, designer of Coursera application, signing off from Bengaluru for ETV Bharat. Prashobh Devanandi.